Shalom, shalom, shalom. Yisrael. This is Yehonatan Dawit with you here again, remotely because of the new world of Corona. This is the what they call the 19th of April, 2020. And I want to continue with Kar Kara Hashiba, the seven called out assemblies. I'm not going to give you the statistics of the coronavirus today as I have been doing. You know, that most of them is bogus. And I keep saying every week, that we're being, the media that you're listening to, looking at, and the social media you're engaging with, you're all being puppeteered to just speak and say and hear what they want you to speak, say, and hear. No one's talking about the overcast that we have over the dome every day. The one season that we have every day for the past, I know, at least a year. Chemtrails, they're bringing down rain full of chemicals. If you want to know, look at the spikes, the death, so-called death rate spikes from the coronavirus. Look at the correlation with the rainfall. Follow the rainfall, follow the torrential rainfalls, and then connect and that to the dots of the so-called spikes and deaths for the coronavirus. Yes, we are being poisoned from the air. You see a lot of stuff on social media about 5G. Some of that is true. And if you look at the history of technology, Yahweh has always been against technology, which is shishabom. He told Abraham, when you make an altar to me, you don't put an axe on it. He didn't even want altars made for him for sacrifice done with tools or equipment, because in that is the beginnings of evil, and we see that today. I was looking at something that was sent to me in 1918 when we had this Spanish flu epidemic. That is when radio waves were being put up all across the world. Now, the radio was invented not too much long before that, you know, maybe like 20 years, about 30 years before that. But you had the wires sent all across the world. This would help get the communication for World War I. And quite incidentally, you had the Spanish flu epidemic. In 1979 is when we got 1G. And that's when we got our mobile phones. What did we have at that time? An outbreak of influenza. 1991, 2G came on board. And that's when we had an outbreak of cholera. You know, when 2G came out, that's when we were able to start texting on our phones. That was like a new thing. And then in 1998, 3G came out. We had another worldwide bout of influenza. And our phones were now able to take pictures, good quality pictures, and some video and all that. And then we got 2009 4G, and we had a worldwide outbreak of H1N1. But the convenience of it was, hey, now you can stream movies on your phone and video and send video of yourself doing stupid stuff all around the world and watch movies. All of this is for convenience. And now with 5G, they even tell you, they can't even tell you all the things that 5G can do. But with 5G, you're going to have your automobiles flying around without any kind of a pilot or driver, and a whole lot of more so-called conveniences for us, each with another wave of technology. All, this is what we don't realize. All electromagnetic field upgrades affect our bodies. Our breathing, it causes inflammation, it affects the fluid in our bodies. And yes, the reactions that you are seeing are true. But the ideology of them, that we are told about them, are lies. And these death tolls are rigged up. It's quite interesting how other deaths in the hospitals are going down. There are many diagnoses that are being attributed to the coronavirus. They are not legitimate. There are many people going out and telling the world this. Hey, listen, my father had a heart attack. He didn't have no coronavirus. You know, I had just a regular cold, and they put me down coronavirus. See, the hospital beds get four times the money for every patient they have diagnosed with the COVID-19. And it's interesting how also they want to get away from that word corona, because they know that Lysol kills it. And it's also interesting how you cannot go out, I don't care if you have a $1,000 bill, you cannot go to a store and buy a can of Lysol. I've been trying for a month now. It's not coincidental. Now, I talked about this about a few weeks ago. In 2004, we had SARS. 2008, we had avian flu. 2010, swine. 2012, MERS. 2014, Ebola. 2016, Zika. 2018, Ebola Part 2, and now we have this corona. It very convenient, and each new wave of these so-called diseases brings on a new change in our world and how we interact and respond and what they want to do. More liberties are lost with each new so-called crises, and these are worldwide crises. But no one talks about the worst flu of all time. On April 17th, 1492, what was unleashed on the world was unprecedented. I call it the 1492 Ocean Blue Flu. And that's when Columbus contracted with King Ferdinand and Isabella from Spain to go about what they thought was the Indies in China for riches and wealth and proselytization of the Lord God Jesus Christ. And we know the rest is history. We're over here now speaking English, and the Lord God Jesus Christ is supposed to be your Redeemer and Savior. The whole world is on lockdown, and the way it looks right now, I'm looking out my window towards the west. That's how I have my office set up. And I'm seeing what I should see every Shabbat. No one should be out buying and selling and working. It should be quiet and peaceful. Now the whole world is being forced to be locked down, and we have peace and serenity, something we should be seeing every Shabbat. Yohanatan Dawit with you here, YahwehForChristians@gmail.com. Remember, there was a movie called Soylent Green. Soylent Green. And what we found at the end of the movie was that it was people. The world was in a crisis, a supposed overpopulation, which is not true. The entire world, every last person in the world can fit in the state of Texas and have room. Everybody just stand in the spot, everybody can fit in the state of Texas. This world is not overpopulated. We've always been given that lie that of the world being overpopulated and not enough food to supply the world. But Monsanto is like Soylent Green. You think they aren't feeding us people? You think they aren't feeding us filth and slop? The whole world for, 150, almost 200 years, has been planned by the Luciferians to bring us together under one order. And that's where we are now. This is the last generation. And I'm talking about these, what you call seven last churches. The Kawal Kara Hash Shiba is very appropriate, because this message was dictated to Yochanan from the very mouth of Yahushua himself. This was sent directly from the mouth of Yahushua to Yochanan while he was on the island of Patmos. Each letter was delivered from a Malachim, what you call an angel, himself, to each of these assemblies directly. And it's about these times right here. We are already under the seals. I'm going to get through this because we're going to talk about We have Thyatira and Sardis on the menu today. And then we're going to finish out with two more before we get to this book of Revelations. This is very appropriate right now. And I'm not being reactionary. This is proactive. This has already been scheduled since the Passover. You know, none of the preachers are telling you that what I just told you about these letters being sent out by angels themselves. So let me show that for you. Revelation 22, 16. So in Revelation 22, 16, it says, I, Yahushua, have sent my Malachim to testify to you these things in the assemblies, in the Kararim. I am the root and the offspring of Dawid, the bright and morning star. Yahushua personally dictated the Gola, what you call Revelations. He dictated this to Yochanan on the Isle of Patmos, and it was hand-delivered from Malachim directly to the leaders of these types of beliefs. These types, actually, is one belief. The whole world, the entire world, is going to be preaching and hearing various aspects of the name of Yahweh. The whole world. Like I said, right now, you can Google the name of God and Yahweh pops up. It's not going to be different kinds of religions. It's going to be one. One world order and one religion, but seven different types. And this was revealed to Yahushua by his father, and he sent it to Yochanan, the beloved disciple, who wrote these letters, dictated by the mouth of Yahushua, and sent to these seven types of assemblies. He who has an ear, let him hear. So right now, we see our preachers, teachers are castrated, told to shut up and just go in the house. Everybody's got to go online to hear the word. Tithes is going down. You can tell how connected you are to the love and worship of this world based on how inconvenient you are in your daily life, your routine life. If you're so hemmed up that you cannot even live your routine life, that shows the connection you have with this world. And we all do to various extents. I haven't even had my hair formally done, in a month or two. So simple things like that, we take for granted. I can't even go out and buy a can of Lysol. Things have changed drastically at my employment. I praise Yah and told Yah that I have a great company to work for. I have not lost any employment, but what I do daily has changed. And this is important because there's only one group of these seven, this Hashiba, only one group that is unaffected by what goes on in this world. We haven't talked about that group yet. But I'll tell you, it's Philadelphia. They are unaffected by any of this because they're not enmeshed in this world as we are. I keep talking about looking up to the sky. Look to the Hashemayim. Look at the clouds. Every day you see overcast. I see overcast out my window right now. But the clouds, the real clouds, come from the west and they go towards the east. Why is that? There's a reason for that. The clouds go towards the east, where Zion is. And if it continues a little further, it goes to the torture stake where Yahushua died on. But there's also another reason, a few reasons deeper than that. I do have a book that I wrote that you can look up and get more information on that. Yehonatan Dawid with you here. So the clouds, the real clouds, go from west to east. You can't Google that nowhere. You can't Google that. The dome is covered. No one's talking about the national debt. No one. 2 years ago on another station, I talked about the national debt and how it's going to bring this nation to its knees. And I listed all the nations and how much debt they were in. Every nation is in some kind. How can everyone be in debt? And one is in debt. Who are they indebted to? The one who is in debt is a slave to the one he's indebted to. The one you're indebted to then has authority over the one who's in debt's life and how they can operate. And we just added $2.2 trillion of stimulation to that debt. And the whole world is in an economic crisis right now. They're falling on their knees. We can't even get Q-tip cotton from, you know, the cotton that we get for our Q-tips comes from China. And we having a hard time getting that to get your nose swabbed or your throat swabbed. The economic crisis is what needs to be looked at. And it cannot be overcome. That's why there is no politician with this agenda on their platform. No one's talking about it, but your humble servant right here. Because everyone has their idea of what they think the mark of the beast is. But everyone agrees, whatever their different beliefs are about this mark of the beast end time system, we do know that you, me, I, we are not going to be able to live our lives in a routine manner. Viz, buying and selling. If that is the case, we need to put all our focus and energies on this buying and selling. Forget all the other garnishes around what the mark of the beast is. It is ultimately about not being able to live your routine life of buying and selling. And that's already right before your face, right now. And nobody is talking about it. You're talking about Corona because you're told to talk about Corona. You're not talking about the worldwide debt. You're not talking about this last generation. This is the last generation. Remember everybody was talking about the year of the release, the 400 years? Well, what is that? That's the 16th generation. But there are 17 generations before we get to the last generation. But at 400, we've already just passed that 400. That 400 number is quite important. It is the length that you've been exiled under the Egyptians and your current length of years that you're exiled here. 400 men of Esau, your Edomite brothers, came up against Jacob. He chose 400 men. Why 400 men? Dawid had 400 men, 400 ruffians. Why 400? Is a special number, but the time of the end is at 430. That's your 17th generation. With a generation being about 25 years, you get 17 times 25. It gets you right about here, right now, this time, this date right here, or close to it. Interestingly enough, you had a man, a boy, that was born last year, and he will be 30 years old at the time of your 430 years. And I told you who that was. We're talking about Thyatira and Sardis. Let's read Revelations 2, 18-29. And talking about Thyatira. Now, Thyatira, to me, all of these so-called churches, we call them Kaharim, to me, they all have a theme of what we see today. Because like I said, all of these are seven types of believers. Seven types. You had the Ephesians, who these are strong, sound Hebrews, but Hebrews without love. Hebrews who know the book, but without love. And then you have Smyrna, who are your Messianic Hebrews. These are what I call the Jew-brews. That is a sect that is growing tremendously. There are so many Jewish brothers receiving the Hebrew name of the Messiah. And they call them Jeshua and Yeshua. But they are one of the types. Pergamos. To me, these are the apostolic Hebrews. There are a lot of Hebrews out here who's out here speaking in tongues and doing all kinds of magic healing with all that fake holy oil. And Thyatira, to me, these are your black Hebrew Israelites. Let's listen what the Revelator in the book of Gola. Gola is a genetic word for genetic peoples that Yahweh Yeshua sent this message to. And that is Gola chapter 2, 18 to 29. Let's read it. And to the Malachim of the assembly in Thyatira write, these things says the Son of Yahweh, who has eyes like a flame of fire, and his feet like fine bronze. Your King James Version will say bronze. The New King James Version says brass. There's a big difference between bronze and brass. Bronze is accurate. Brass represents Hashatan. Bronze represents Yahushua. It's a big difference, and it matters. I have a book about that where I explain that. I know your works, love, service, faith, and your patience. And as for your word, your works, the last are more than the first. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you, because you allow that woman, Jezebel, and we're talking about Thyatira here, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. And I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. Indeed, I will cast her into a sickbed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds. I will kill her children with death, and all the Karaim, this book says churches, will know that I am he who speaks, who searches the mind and hearts, and I will give to each one of you according to your works. Now to you I say, and to the rest of Thyatira, as many as do not have this doctrine, who have not known the depths of Satan, as they say, I'll put on you no other burden, but hold fast what you have till I come. And he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nations. He will rule them with a rod of iron. They will be dashed in pieces like a potter's vessel, as I also have received from my Father, and I will give him the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Ruach has to say to the Kaharim. Interesting, in all of the Hashiba assemblies, only one was not told to he who has an ear, let him hear. That Hebraism means individual responsibility. Each of these assemblies are admonished that he, she, you, I, we, me, who hears this, are responsible for the message that was given. This is why scribes and Pharisees, when they attacked Yahweh Yeshua, covered their ears up. They did not even want to hear what he was saying, because then they'll be responsible for it. Once you hear something, you cannot unhear it. You are forever changed. Faith comes by hearing, not by what you see, because what you see is deceiving. That's why they are messing with the dome right now, to get all those who live by their eyesight. Shema, hear. If you have an ear, hear, obey, do. And only one, we haven't got to them yet, was not even told that. He who has an ear, let him hear. And you'll see why. A lot of great things by Thyatira. A lot of good stuff. But, you know, it's good to have love and service and faith and patience. As a matter of fact, their works got even better. They did even more great things. But how can you have a Jezebelian woman up on the pulpit running stuff. How can you have a Jezebelian woman who teaches sexual immorality? You know, one of the things that we're missing is when the world ends, it ends with 100-pound fiery boulders pelting the earth. It's just not flame just being thrown out. These are 100-pound boulders, flaming, incinerating boulders, pelting the damned. Yahweh is stoning the damned. That's stoning. And the law of Moshe gives two reasons for one to be stoned. One of them is blasphemy. And in the end times, everyone not accepting, receiving, and calling on the name of Yahweh Shua is blasphemous. And the other reason is sexual immorality. You see, one of the things about sexual immorality, it is what brings the next generation of sinners through. Improperly using the womb and the seed to bring forth another generation. So for that reason, they're stoning. Blasphemy and sexual immorality. They stoned Yahushua for blasphemy. You didn't know that. You just thought he just hung up there and died. Hebrews, on the way to the Passover, stopped in the road and stoned him when they saw the judgment above his head that he was up there for blasphemy. So we are responsible for that. We stoned his son, and those who do not receive his son will be stoned for your sexual immorality and your blasphemy. Blasphemy is altering the name of Yahushua. Blasphemy is calling him any other name than the name he told you he was. And in each one of these admonitions to each one of these seven assemblies, he always precedes it with who he is. And if you look at it, he says who he is in a unique way to each group. Read behind me. He doesn't introduce himself the same way. He introduces himself a different way to each group that's specific to them. Here's this group. This is why I say this is the, to me, they look like the black Hebrew Israelites. Because he tells them by the look of his eyes and look of his feet. So he's given a physical description of himself. And black Hebrew Israelites are so strong about Yahushua being black. Black, 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 this, black, that. As if that's what's going to get you into the kingdom. And it's not. That's why at the end, he says that he has eyes that search the mind and the heart. Because it's what's in your mind and your heart, not what's on your skin. You have no say-so in what your skin color looks like. But you do have say-so in what you think and what you set your heart on. You do have say-so in what you put your emotions on. Yahushua says, for these, he gave space to repent. Now, offering things to idols, get out of your mind this old way of actually going into a church with an animal and slaughtering it and having sex all in the church. There are a whole lot of different ways of doing this. Let me see. Job 18, I should have some time. We have an hour broadcast today. Let's go to Job 18, 11 through 19. Let's read this. Okay, verse 11 says, terrors frightening him on every side and drive him to his feet. His strength is starved, and destruction is ready at his side. It devours patches of his skin. The firstborn of death devours his limbs. He is uprooted from the shelter of his tent, and they parade him before the king of terrors. Reading on verse 15. They dwell in his tent who are none of his. Brimstone is scattered on his dwelling. His roots are dried out below, and his branch withers above. The memory of him perishes from the earth, and he has no name among the renowned. He is driven from light into darkness, and he chases and chased out of the world. This is a man with a whole bunch of mamas, a whole bunch of babies by different mamas, and he is being emptied by it. What's waiting for a man like this is stoning. It's stoning. So when you go to an assembly, who allows this? Allows for women, and you're baptizing and you're receiving tithes of women in there who are teaching and who have, is, you know, if you come in with three children by three different men, that's different. But you don't come in and continue to have another boyfriend and pregnant with another child. That's supposed to stop. He says he gave this woman space to repent. He gave her time to repent. You don't continue in that way. And we have assemblies that we worship in where we have men and women just dating, having children, and not even plan on marrying, and they're treating it as if that's normal. As is okay. They're not being admonished from the pulpit from doing this because they're paying their tithes. If you are not married in the name of Yahushua, you should not be sleeping with another person. And that person had better be of the opposite sex. And you are not supposed to be sitting under a woman opening the Torah telling you anything about it. That's not her job, Thyatira. That's not her job. When Yahushua says repent, it means to change the mind in respects to sin. Change the mind. And to be sorry for the sin. But sorrow alone is not repentance. Repentance comes with faith. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Yahushua. How do we sacrifice the idols? We do. You know what? All those black Hebrew Israelites just got finished with the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Just got finished. What in the world are you doing celebrating the Feast of Unleavened Bread a month late? Unless you have been undefiled for some reason, you have no reason for celebrating the Passover and Unleavened Bread a month later. That's the only reason for doing that. And I'm going to talk about why Yahushua allowed that too. There's a reason for that. And you're going to learn. But so that's false worship. It's false worship. And we sacrifice to idols every Christmas, every Thanksgiving, every Easter, all part of paganism. This is what Yahushua is talking about. People who call on his name are doing this. It is a lie that there will not be tribulation and persecution for Yahweh's people. Stop saying you're not going to be persecuted. There's only one group who will not be. Every last person on this earth is going to have some trials and tribulations. Yahushua says, I am he who searches the heart and the mind, and I give my reward for your works. See, here's the thing that he said about, and I think Thyatira, they seem like the black Hebrew Israelites to me. Here's what Yahweh's going to do. Their tribulation is going to be a testimony to all the assemblies. He's going to use them as an example. As an example. Remember, he says, judgment starts at the house of Israel. He's going to use them as an example to everyone else. When you see what he does to his own people in this time right here, you will tremble and you will fear. What should they do? He said, let's go to Acts 15. He told them to go back to the basics. And what are the basics? Acts 15, 28 and 29. Acts 15, 28 and 29. For it seemed good to Ruach HaKodesh, to us, to lay upon you no other great burden than these necessary things, that you abstain from things offered to idols, from blood, from things strangled, and from sexual immorality. If you keep yourself from these, you do well. And that's what you Black Hebrew Israelites need to do. Go back to the basics. We already know, and as this council says, we already know you're keeping the Sabbath. You're doing the basic things. You know to keep the commandments. They're not talking about that. That wasn't the issue of keeping the Sabbath and keeping the commandments. That wasn't the issue. They already knew they had to keep Passover and the unleavened bread and Shavuot and all those things. But they were doing extra. And that's what Hebrew Israelites need to do. Just go back to the basics. Go back to the basics. The basics is on the foundation of the name of Yahweh Shua. And that's what this ministry is about. Everything that's talked about is going to tie into him. Yahweh Shua is the X-Man. All things go through him. And all things come from him. Because you don't want that white throne judgment. You don't want that. He who has an ear, let him hear. Yahweh Shua says, I am the morning star. He adds no burden to you further than this. Hold fast. Keep my works. Keep my works. And then he will give you rule. Hebrew Israelites always talking about how they're going to have you licking their feet and kissing their feet and carrying their children on their shoulders. That can all be true. Yahweh Shua says, if you follow my works, keep my works. My works is the Besor message, teaching the kingdom of Yah. No other extra stuff. This Hebrew national rule, you cannot rule anything on this earth. You can't even rule what comes out of your mouth. You run nothing but your mouth because you own nothing on this earth. You cannot mount up any kind of fighting or offense against the man. You cannot do it. You can't even make a pop gun. So stop it. Go back to the basics. Go back to the basics. Thyatira. See, like I said, Yahweh Shua has... In all of these letters, he introduced himself in a specific way based on the characteristics of this specific type. Type means you have something that sets the example for all others that's going to come in the future like it. There's going to only be seven types of worshipers on the earth, all various aspects of the name of Yahweh Shua. And the Thyatira type is this type I'm talking about now. How did he introduce himself to the Ephesians? As he who holds the seven stars. That's Ruach, and talks about being in the lampstand. That's Ruach HaKodesh. He's letting these people know that, hey, I know you love me, you keep my, you stand fast in my name, you have Ruach HaKodesh, but you forgot that by losing your first love. They're good at vetting out Jezebels. There's no Jezebels in the Ephesonian faith. They don't have Jezebels in there because they vet them out. But here's the problem they have. They do things without love. If you do something sans love, you are a sounding ass, a sounding brass. No one gets into the kingdom without love. Yahweh Shua died for you because of love. So how are you going to get into the kingdom if you don't have love? It doesn't matter that you know the Bible. The devil knows the Bible. It is nothing. I'm not impressed by any man who knows the Bible who doesn't love me. I'm not impressed. It doesn't mean anything to me because the devil knows the Bible. Smyrna, he says, I'm the first and the last. Smyrna has a specific type of tribulation they're going to go through. They're going to have a 10-day trial persecution. And I told you when that time was. It's going to be between the feast days. That's why you have to know the true time of the feast days. You have to know this. You're not going to understand what's going on unless you know the true date of the feast days. And those who follow the Jewish calendar got them wrong. You got them wrong. You just got finished celebrating the Feast of Weeks, and you were a month late. And then, so for Pergamos, he introduces himself as with the two-edged sword, his mouth. That means his mouth pierces, it goes through all that stuff that they're talking about. They don't truly believe the word of Yahweh. And now we're talking about Thyatira. Now, the thing about Thyatira also that's unique is this sickbed. Because they are so wicked with fornication, they're going to have sicknesses in Thyatira. People who are Thyatira type, they have a lot of sicknesses in their assembly. A lot of them are sick, and a lot of their children are dying in the streets. I know Hebrew Israelites who talks about their children dying in the streets. Their sons and daughters are dying in the streets. This is the lot of those who worship under Jezebelian authority, who have love and service and faith and patience, but they have improper headship, improper leadership, and they allow for non-disciplined type living. And the disciple is a disciplined one. It is undisciplined to sleep around and to allow paganism into what is true. You cannot bring Easter and Christmas into your worship, or no aspects of it. Sardis. Now, let me see. With Thyatira, I have some more to say about that, but I want to move on. I don't want to go past my time. So, going back to this last generation, why is it that Enoch and Elijah are coming back? These are the only two men that have gone to Hashemayim having not died. And we know the word says the soul that sins must die. And they will die. They will. You know what's going to kill them? Hebrews. Because when they come back, why Enoch? Enoch was the voice for the last generation of the first ending of the world. Elijah is the voice of the last generation. And Yahushua is the Elijah type. Remember, his disciples said, Master, we were told that the end would come when Elijah is here. And Yahushua's response was, Elijah is here for those who accept it. So he was the Elijah type. So we got two men who's going to come back and give a witness. We haven't talked about that yet. Enoch and Elijah, they're going to come back and be a witness in these last days. We haven't gotten to that yet, but this is why. This is why. Because both of them, their message is for the end time. It's for the end time. And we are in that time. You know, with this corona, they're making your hand is the offender. Your hand and your mouth. Your mouth is supposed to speak the Besor message, which you call the gospel, and your hand is the agreement. Your hand is agreement, is work, is revelation. Yahweh's hand, it opens, it reveals, it's a revelation. And now here we are in this world today where your hand is an offender to the world. You have to keep your hands to yourself. You can't do keep you from working. And Yahweh's hand is about agreement. It's Yahad. The hand is Yahad, and agreement is Yahad. The hand is important. And also, as he opens it, it reveals what's going on. And we're living in a world of this corona where the hand is the offender. Enoch and Elias are going to come back, and they're going to reveal. But what are these Hebrew Israelites going to do? They're going to kill them. Sardis. Sardis is Revelation 3. Sardis is Revelation 3, 1 through 6. Let's read Sardis. And to the Malachim of the assembly in Sardis write. This is Yahushua talking directly out of his mouth to Yochanan. He's dictating to him. And this message gets delivered. Amalekim flies from the island to Sardis and appears into the assembly and reads it to them. This is deep. This is heavy. This is how all of these messages got about. And it's important because after this, he talks about the plagues and the judgments. Right now, we're already under the seals. And we'll get into that. So, these things says he who has the seven spirits of Yahweh and the seven stars, I know your works. You have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found your works perfect before Yahweh. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard. Hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. You have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments, and they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his Malachim. He who has an ear, let him hear what Ruach has to say to the Kaharal, to the assemblies. You are individually responsible for that. It says that he introduces himself again as the Spirit of Yah. That's what Sardis. So these people claim to have Ruach HaKodesh. Now, this is Ephraim. The Sardis group, the Sardis type is Ephraim. I doubt that there is a larger group growing right now than what's called the Torah movement. These, to me, are your rednecks 2.0. You go to any of these groups, these are your typical so-called white boys. They got the beautiful hair and the big, beautiful beards. And they're claiming to be Ephraim. And this didn't crop up until the mid-90s. Mid to late 90s. Actually, the late 90s. Like 97. 1997. Cropped up like mushrooms. All over, you've got so-called white people who are accepting the name of Yahweh. Of course, they call him Yahuwah. They call him Yahuwah. The Messianic groups call him Yeshua, and the Torah groups call him Yahuwah. For the most part, that's how that goes. These Sardis people, this is exploding. They have a bigger following. They have the reputation. Because sadly as it may be, when a man says something, it's more believed. If it's a white man, a black man can say one thing and a white man say the same thing. If a white man is saying it, more will believe him than a black man. That's just the way it goes. So they have reputation and they have strong foundational beliefs. They believe in the Torah. They believe in the feast days. They believe in a name. They keep all this. They believe in marriage and children and one wife and all that good stuff. They believe in all these things. But what is their admonition? They're really dead. Their works are not perfect because their works deny you, really. You will not see, I have never seen, and I tell you, you cannot see. And I've spoken to them and talked with them and had dialogue with them. They will not have a black man over them. No one in this Torah movement has a black headship, a black man headship. They have denied, really, the personage of the Messiah. We do know, like I said, just like with the black Hebrew Israelites, they've been admonished because their theme is also as being saved because you're black. And then Sardis is being saved. This is the slave man remade, the slave man 2.0. They're denying the blackness. So both sides are wrong. Both sides are wrong. Sardis, you're not going to be saved if you act like slavery didn't happen. If you act like the whole world was taken over and it's okay now because you take on the name of Yahweh. So all of a sudden it's okay because you receive the name of Yahweh and everything's fine, hunky-dory. You will not rule over Yahweh's people. It's not going to happen. Here's what's missing in the understanding of Sardis. Yahushua says that they need to remember where they came from. He says if they don't, he's going to come upon them as a thief. Matthew 25, 1 through 3. Let me read Matthew 25, 1 through 13, actually. Matthew 25, 1 through 13. Then the kingdom of heaven will be likened to 10 virgins. The thing about Matthew, he's the only one that really calls the kingdom of Yahweh the kingdom of heaven. And he does this a lot. He does this, I think it's like, well, I counted it, 32 times in Matthew's alone. And the kingdom of heaven, see, Matthew wrote to the Hebrews. He wrote specifically to the Hebrews. And that's why he called the kingdom of heaven. But the others, Daniel and all the other disciples used the kingdom of Yahweh. So he says, now five of them, talking about these virgins, this is important. Five of them were wise and five were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose, trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest there should be not enough for us and you. But go rather to those who sell and buy for yourself. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. So they went out buying and selling. And while they did that, the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins also came, saying, Master, Master, open to us. But he answered and said to them, assuredly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. That's Sardis. That's Sardis. See, Sardis, this is, I tell you, Torah movement people. They out there, they keep the days wrong. They don't acknowledge you as the original Hebrews. But they have the spirit, but it runs out. They still are enmeshed in the world. See, the lamp oil represents Ruach HaKodesh. Of course, the groom is Yahushua. Those who have Ruach HaKodesh are ready. They're ready. They are ready and they go in with him. Half of the Hebrew Israelites aren't going to make it. Half of this group is not going to make it. And those numbers are given for a specific reason. They're not haphazard. Because 10 represents the authority of government, any government. 10, that's what the number 10 represents. And five is a grace number. Five is a grace number. I don't have a whole lot of time to go into all of this, but five is a grace number. You know, six is the number of man. So before man came, Yahweh already had grace covered. Everything he had before him was grace. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Five is the grace number. So you had 10 virgins who all under the authority of Yahweh. They all called on the name of Yahweh. They all believed on him. But only five received his grace. Remember, the Sardis, they are Ephraimites, and they call themselves the Torah movement. All about that law, 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 law. What about grace? What about grace? Five is number for grace. Only five got in. You keep the law, that means they were there, per the law, where you're supposed to be, and they went in by the grace of the Messiah. It's even deeper than that. Don't have a whole lot of time to go into it. But that, Matthew 25, 1 through 13, the parable of the 10 virgins is for the Sardonians. So we see that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It was at hand then, but where is it now? See, at hand for the poor, the righteous, the persecuted, they keep the commandments. But true righteousness is to do all in the name of Yahweh. The true message is the Besorah message. All we're supposed to be teaching and preaching now is the Besorah message. just like the days of Noah. This was Enoch. That's why Enoch was the messenger for the last generation that died in the first ending of the world. And his hand was Noah. And Noah did not have no other messages other than to get into the Tibah. Get into the ark. The ark is Yahushua. Today is the same message. The world is coming to an end. Stop. Get off of social media for all this other dumb stuff. The message is get into the T-ball, get into the ark, Yahushua. If you can't speak on that every week, you're not worth your salt. You're not worth your salt. When the cry came out to the 10 virgins, that's the blowing of the trumpet. That's the blowing of the shofar. The shofar blew and only half of them were ready. Only half. The half of them had to go into the world to get themselves ready, and it was too late. Shavuot is going to be a month late for those who just got finished celebrating the Feast of Unleavened Bread. You're going to be a month late for Shavuot. After Shavuot came the pouring of Ruach HaKodesh. The Ruach HaKodesh poured into those who were ready, who were on time, who had their lamps trimmed, who were ready. And from there, they went out and did great things. Great things. There's going to be some great things coming up for those who are filled with Ruach HaKodesh. You have to be on time. You cannot be foolish. This is the time of the end. If Yahushua said then, over 2,000 years ago, that he's coming quickly, and here we are 2,000 years later, and we're still not taking it seriously, we're supposed to always have a sense of urgency. When I get finished with these seven assemblies, you're going to see how we must always have a sense of urgency. Yahushua didn't want anybody to sit back and relax and say, oh yeah, I know when he's going to come, and then relax. We're supposed to always have a sense of urgency. Yes, we all have our ideas, and we prognosticate when we think it's going to happen. But today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. You don't know what's going to happen to your life is in your nostrils. You could die tonight after dinner. You can die on your way to work. If he doesn't come for a million years or 2 days, what does it matter to you? Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. This is Yahweh for Christians at gmail.com. Yohanan.weet with you here. Next week, Philadelphia. We're going to talk about Philadelphia. Until then, shalom, shalom to your home. Hallelujah.
Thank you, my brother.
Torah, thank you.